Greetings, friends. Welcome to the Sabbath School Bible Study Discussion. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for gathering us one more time to learn from your word. And as we learn, we pray that you will lead us through your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Last week, we looked at the beginning of the gospel. We learned who Mark was, and we learned about the baptism of Jesus and how it fulfilled the 70 weeks prophecy. This week, we'll be looking at the calling of the disciples and what happened just after the calling. Each gospel begins with Jesus's call for the disciples, and there is a certain narrative that follows. For example, in Matthew, after the calling of the disciples, there is a Sermon on the Mount. And in Luke, it is a Sabbath in the synagogue, and Jesus tells, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and I have come to heal," and etc. John records that right after the calling of the disciples, they attended the wedding at Cana. But in Mark, we see another contrast. Just like Luke, Mark says that they spent a Sabbath in Capernaum together. But what happens on that Sabbath is really an unforgettable experience, and we'll be looking at that. But the question comes to us in this lesson, did the disciples follow Jesus like really immediately, even before thinking about it? And I want to ask, in your life, have you made a sudden decision to follow Jesus just like that, or have you thought this through any time?
I guess none of us have made a sudden decision. I guess we all have gone through, you know, we go to church, we listen to sermons after sermons, but our hearts have always been very hard. Mm-hmm. And when we listen to sermon, you know, there must be one sermon in all our lives which transforms our lives.
Yes.
And so as we grow, as we listen to the sermons, there comes a day where we really give our hearts to Christ. And so it takes time, it takes progress. Yeah.
Yeah, it does take time. And even for the disciples, especially when we are talking about the disciples in this lesson, Peter, his brother Andrew, James, and his brother John, we are talking about these four people. You see, in John chapter 1, when Jesus was getting baptized, John the Baptist hears the words from heaven, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." And then John tells to two of his disciples, and the Bible identifies one of them as Andrew, who is the brother of Simon, which is Peter, and he says, "Behold the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world." And immediately, after the second declaration that Jesus is the Lamb of God again, these two disciples, they start following Jesus. In fact, they spent the rest of the evening with Jesus until 4 p.m. when Jesus got baptized, and the next day when they saw Jesus. And they didn't immediately follow Jesus right after that. They did get the call, but they didn't follow Jesus. It is clearly recorded, and the Bible commentators say it took around 2 years, two autumns, for them to make the decision to completely leave everything and follow Jesus. They had learned about the power of Jesus, the testimony from heaven itself, but then it took them some time until they're convinced, and then they made the decision of leaving everything and following Jesus. Now, in our lesson, the author also points out that Peter and his brother Andrew were not that financially secured, while John and his brothers James, they were secured. But the call comes to both of them. What do you have to say about that?
Point here is that Jesus calls, the author points out, and he says Jesus calls to discipleship both those who have less resources and those with more. We see that Matthew was a tax collector, whereas Peter, he was an uneducated person. So education, qualification, riches, money, it doesn't matter with God. When we really carry our cross and when we really submit ourselves, that's the true discipleship God is asking from us.
So it is not about talents or resources, but it is about commitment.
Yes.
Even in John chapter 6, we see the same thing. Many people, they follow Jesus because of the bread that he's providing. But yeah, these disciples, they didn't follow Jesus because of anything else. but because of their pure commitment.
I guess whether you are rich or whether you are poor, whether you are educated or whether you are uneducated, no matter whether you are weak or whether you are strong in scripture, Jesus still calls you. Yes. And then I guess at the end of the lesson, I guess you're going to speak about that. At the end of this question, it says, he calls them to follow him, that is to become his disciples. He indicates that if they will respond to his call, he will take on the task of making them fishers of men. You see, when we give our lives to God, Jesus calls everyone. And when he calls, he tells us that he doesn't leave us alone. When he calls us for his ministry, he doesn't leave us alone, but he says that I will be with you and I will train you. You don't have to be scared. That's what he told to Jeremiah also.
Yeah.
When he called Jeremiah, Jeremiah said, "No, God, I cannot speak." But God said, "Do not be afraid of their faces. I will touch your lips." And he touched, and he put his words, and he said, "Go where I tell you to go. Speak to the people what I tell you to what I command you to tell." And we see that's what Jeremiah did.
Exactly, that's where the key text for this lesson falls in the right place. It reads from Mark chapter 1 verse 17, "Then Jesus said to them, follow me and I will make you become fishes of men." Jesus doesn't say, "I will make you fishes of men" directly, but "I will make you become, I will train you, I will be the one to take on that task." Now, immediately is the word that Mark uses again and again. In fact, more than 40 times. Some people say it is 41, some others say 42. But the thing is, immediately is the word that Mark uses again and again to emphasize that Jesus is a man of action.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, in whole chapter 1 of Mark, Jesus has very less words. All that he is doing is just on doing action. His emphasis is on action. And we will look at the first action of Jesus and his newly elected disciples or chosen disciples. What did they experience right after their call?
We have heard this term, or we have heard the sentence that, which says, the first impression leaves a mark. And so, the first event that the disciples encounter here or experience here is something that they have been doing all their lives. They go to synagogue, they listen to sermons on Sabbath. They go back to their lives, but this time something has happened to them.
Mm-hmm.
Not only to the disciples, but also to the people who have been in the synagogue. Jesus and the disciples goes to the synagogue right after the calling. They go and Jesus starts preaching. And as he preaches, the verse says, "And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes." Mark chapter 1 verse 22.
Mm-hmm.
And not only the people who were there were astonished, but I guess also the disciples who were just called. You know, the four disciples, they were just called.
Mm-hmm.
And they followed Jesus. They left everything immediately and they went behind Jesus. And they see something big happening. Mm-hmm. So this, while Jesus called this disciples, you know, Jesus only said one thing. He said, "Follow me." And the disciples immediately left everything and they followed. They have experienced this before, the power of Jesus. I mean, the power in the words of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Because when Jesus said, "Follow me," the disciples understood there is something that Jesus did not have to explain anything. He just said, "Follow me." He implied all his intentions in that word and they followed. So these disciples have already experienced the words of Jesus before.
Mm-hmm.
And now they are experiencing again. And not only the disciples, but here we are reading about the people who are gathered in the synagogue. And so we see, we also read, "As Jesus was teaching, a demon-possessed man, no doubt impacted by the power of Jesus' teaching." Not only the people, not only the disciples, but also a demon-possessed person was impacted by the words of Jesus.
And that is truly startling, because the scribes and the Pharisees have been teaching in the synagogue and this man was silent. And suddenly out of the blue, Jesus comes and teaches and he is already getting impacted, and he's shouting. He is shouting. And this tells me that when the truth is proclaimed in power, with authority, people's lives get impacted and demons will start shouting. Yes. And that's what we want that to happen in our churches every time.
You know, we all are also like a demon-possessed people.
Yeah.
You know, we all have our sins to carry.
Mm-hmm.
And when we have sins, we think that we cannot go to God.
Mm-hmm.
We will not be set free. Sometimes we feel like we are going to die. Sometimes we feel so hopeless.
Yeah.
You know, the same feeling this demon-possessed man had. He felt hopeless.
In fact, Ellen White says that these were not actually the words that the demon-possessed man wanted to speak.
Mm.
When Jesus was speaking, he felt that he is the one who would heal me, deliver me from my sins, from Satan, the power of Satan. But when he opened his mouth to utter the words, help me, the demon possessed his mouth, took control over him, and he said, why did you come here in the first place?
Mm. And so, as this demon-possessed man feels hopeless, you know, as you said, Ellen White mentioned that he wants to be saved. He sees Jesus there. You know, I don't know if he has been there for years listening to sermons or whatever. But that Sabbath, he had a change of heart.
An unforgettable experience.
Yes. Again, an unforgettable experience for this demon-possessed man.
Mm-hmm.
He may be listening to sermons Sabbath after Sabbath, but on that Sabbath, the sermon has impacted him and he wants to be saved now. He sees a savior right before his eyes. He wants to be saved. He goes, but then he is not able to because the demon has taken control, like Ophir has said. And now Jesus sees this person and he says, be quiet.
Mm-hmm.
Why does Jesus say be quiet? There's something that is that this demon has told. Mm-hmm. In the public.
Yeah.
The demon says, you are the Holy One of God. He acknowledges that Jesus is the Holy One of God.
Mm.
The demon knows that Jesus is the Son of God. And so it publicly shouts aloud that you are the Son of God, you are the Holy One of God. And so Jesus commands him, be quiet. And he says, get out of this man. And the demon goes out. You know, as we read, while reading Ellen White's comment, it says that Satan did not want to leave the body. When Jesus said, go out of this person, Satan did everything not to leave that person with all his strength. You know, if you had seen a demon-possessed man, you know how strong that demon-possessed man is.
Mm-hmm.
It speaks with loud voice. It can carry almost 4 to 5 people in one hand. It is very hard to control the demon-possessed man.
Mm-hmm.
And so, if in a normal setting like this, when a demon-possessed man can be that strong, then here Satan is trying everything in his strength not to leave the man. But you see, even that demon sees the power in the words of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus says, go, and then this demon, he tries everything, but he cannot. He has to leave because it is the word of Christ.
Yeah. And truly it must have been an unforgettable experience. And that's what Jesus wants us to do as well. Everybody thinks that when Jesus had come to earth, he will deliver them from the Roman oppression, from the taxes, and from their military power and all. But here is Jesus humbly going to a simple synagogue, and he delivers people who have been afflicted by Satan. And today, there might be some things which are holding us back, pulling us down, and we have nourished and cherished our secret sins so much so that we don't want to leave. But this will be the case for every one of us who will keep on holding to our sins. Satan will do everything in his strength to not leave us. But today, the words of Christ, they speak to us. He says, hold thy peace and come out of it. Today, we can also have an unforgettable experience with Jesus when we just make the decision to follow him. And maybe that is one of the reasons why Jesus wanted that demon to be quiet, because people were not ready to receive him. Yeah. Now, right after the Sabbath they spent in the synagogue, they had the worship service and all. What did Jesus do right after that church service? Did he go back, or did he go back for ministry, or did he go back to rest? What did he do?
Thank you for that question. We see here in the Tuesday's lesson, we see the title which says More Sabbath Ministry, mm-hmm. which simply means Jesus was extending his ministerial part, mm-hmm. especially on the Sabbath day.
Mm-hmm.
Just now we were listening about the deliverance ministry Jesus had performed. Mm-hmm. But if you see in Mark chapter 1, verse 29 to 34, we see that Jesus reclines himself. Jesus and his disciples goes to the house of Peter.
Mm-hmm.
And we see here that Peter's mother-in-law. So we can evidently, there is a proof here that Peter was married.
Mm-hmm.
So we see that Peter's mother-in-law was sick. The Bible says that she was suffering with fever. And if you see in Luke chapter 4 verse 38, Luke was a physician. Dr. Luke, we say. Luke was mm-hmm. a physician. And Luke, he acknowledges and he says that it was a great fever. So it was okay. something more than a fever. So if you see in Luke chapter 4 38, we find that. So the Bible commentary says that if you see in Greek, the word fever is puresso. So the word pur means fire. So we can see the word that is used is fire there. So it was so extreme
mm-hmm.
to the point. And also the presence of marshland, and it was not very far from Capernaum. And because of the subtropical temperature and weather over there, we see here that it suggests that the Bible scholars suggest that it would have been malaria.
Malaria. Okay.
So the point here is Jesus goes and he heals the mother-in-law of Peter. So Sabbath is not only meant to go to church, worship God, but also it is of deliverance ministry. Jesus does twice the ministry here. He casts out the demon, and he goes and heals the mother-in-law of Peter. So I think even the church that is present here, especially if we plan out these kind of things, going mm-hmm. out, praying for the sick, especially on Sabbath day,
mm-hmm.
it's a blessing. We are following the method of Jesus. And we see that right after Jesus had healed her, we see that she came and she served them. So the commentary, the writer here says, those who have been saved, healed by Jesus, will minister to others as a result. So it's like we are investing, as Solomon says, cast the bread on the water and you will find it. So while we pray, and when they are healed, they will minister unto us and to God.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the best thing Jesus had did right after the Sabbath service, which was so much productive in Peter's life.
And I'm also looking at the fact the disciples are right now called for a full-time ministry. And what Jesus does is he doesn't take them right away from there to other parts of the land, but he goes right into their hometown. He spends time in their home for the Sabbath,
mm-hmm.
like letting them have that home experience, because they'll be leaving home very soon.
Mm-hmm.
And what other time is best time to spend time with family other than the Sabbath day, right?
That's
Sabbath
it.
Afternoon is the best time that we can spend. And as you said, the ministry just keeps on extending,
mm-hmm.
that even after the Sabbath ends, until late night, people keep on flocking to
yeah.
Peter's house to be healed, to be touched by Jesus, and to be delivered by Jesus from demons.
And now, so we see that Peter's house is now the house of healing.
Amen.
It was his house where sickness originated,
mm-hmm.
but now it became the house of healing where many came
mm-hmm.
and they were healed over there. What a blessing it was yeah. for Peter and his mother-in-law.
I think that can happen even to our houses. When
exactly.
we welcome Jesus, our houses can become houses of prayer, houses of healing. And this is real. When Jesus is in our homes, it is just a different experience. But the question comes to us. This Jesus has power over the demons. He has authority when he speaks. He speaks and the sick get healed. He touches and they will be made whole. what kind of power is this, and where did he get this power from? What is his secret?
Well, you see, the secret of Jesus is nothing but prayer.
Just prayer?
Just prayer. There's nothing else. There's prayer and there's relationship with God. Without prayer, there's no relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't pray and you only read scripture, what's the use?
Mm-hmm.
You might be reading the word of God, but to understand it and to listen to God, what he tells you to do on that day or what he tells you to do in your life, you need to pray. You need to talk to God. You need to have a connection both ways, not in a single way.
Mm-hmm.
And so Jesus, the secret of Jesus' ministry or the secret of Jesus' power, whether in his words or whether in his actions like healing or whatever may be, it is all because of the prayer that he has done. We see right after the event that has happened in the house of Peter, after that sunset, while we read that, it says, not until the last sufferer had been relieved did Jesus cease his work. It was far into the night when the multitude departed, and silence settled down upon the home of Simon.
It was late into the night.
Yes. When does the silence come? You know, many times we see vehicles, noises everywhere, and we see people, noises and full of noise everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
But then there comes silence when it's dark.
And everyone goes to bed.
Yes, when there's late at night.
Mm-hmm.
And so we see Jesus was healing till the late of the night.
Mm-hmm.
And so again, as we read, the long exciting day was past and Jesus sought rest. Jesus sought rest.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to sleep.
Uh-huh.
But while the city was still wrapped in slumber, the Savior, rising up a great while before day, went out and departed in a solitary place and there prayed.
Let's say he slept around 11:30 and then he got up around 3:30.
Maybe.
Something like that.
So, no, because I've been telling to God since I have slept very late this night, please wake me up at 6:30 in the morning so that I can have enough sleep.
Yes.
But Jesus is waking up even before the sun could rise.
Yes. So many of us, we give more importance to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
For many of us, if we don't sleep for 7 hours or 8 hours, it is really hard to stand in the day or to work, to do our works, to listen in the class.
Mm-hmm.
But we see Jesus gives priority to God the Father.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we see what Jesus does is, he wakes up early in the morning. He was very tired last night when he did that, when he was healing.
Mm-hmm.
He was very tired. He was very weak.
Mm-hmm.
He sought for rest. He wanted to sleep.
Mm-hmm.
He slept, but he got up in few hours. He went to God the Father. So I want to ask the question, who can love like Jesus? Who can love the Father like Jesus?
Yeah.
It is only Jesus who can do this.
And I don't think this is the first time. We read again and again that Jesus was tired, but he would still pray.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so all his strength comes from his prayer.
And I've heard a preacher saying this in a sermon, that his father, when he was a child, would pray throughout the night.
Mm.
Like, because this preacher, he gets hungry every 4 hours. He gets up and goes into the kitchen every night and he keeps on eating food. And every time he passes by, he sees his father praying, kneeling down. And then one day he went and asked his father, aren't you tired? Because you are a contract worker, you are doing labor every day. But how are you able to spend the whole nights in prayer? He said, you will know it when you start doing it. Then the man gets to know, and then he starts to pray whole nights, not just right away. The relationship with God has increased over the time, and he is now able to spend the whole time in prayer. And he says that it is more refreshing than when he had slept.
Mm-hmm.
And then he encourages the believers, the newly believers, to pray and at least sleep while praying. What is good than to sleep in the presence of the Father, right? Instead of sleeping away from the presence of Father, sleep in the presence of Father. It's not that we are encouraging you to pray the whole night, but what we are trying to say is that is how important prayer was to Jesus.
Exactly.
That it is more than sleep. Even if he is tired, he will make it a point to pray. And then, immediately after the Sabbath experience, the night has passed. Jesus wakes up early in the morning and they go to different places and they encounter a man full of leprosy. And in fact, the author says it's a dreaded skin disease. Like everything is falling apart. But something different happens. While everybody is pushing him away, telling him not to come close, Jesus does something different. What does he do?
Thank you for the question. We see this story in Mark chapter 1, verse 40 to 45, these verses we see. And I can say this is an underrated story of faith.
Mm-hmm.
If you see the situation at that time, we see that Jesus was not a popular figure at that time. Jesus was not doing many miracles. He was just at the beginning stage. And we see, and also we see that Naaman was the last person who was healed from leprosy. And it was 800 years from then that this leper was healed. And we also see that it was a popular belief at that time. That's what the writer says, that it was a curse from God. Blindness and leprosy, people used to say that it was a curse from God because of their sins. And the third one is that the ritual law, or the Moses' law, it strictly prohibited that no leper should enter into the premises and should come in contact with other people. We see this in Leviticus chapter 13, verse 45. The point here is that Jesus was still in the beginning stage. But we see here that the word that this man or the leper uses is, "If thou wilt, thou can make me clean. If thou will, you can make me clean." I really loved this sentence. The leper, he never knew about Jesus, but he simply comes in faith and he says, if you can, you will heal me. So that's the point. So through his faith, the leper was healed from his leprosy. He did not know Jesus properly. Comparatively, if we see in Jesus' latter ministry, everyone knew about Jesus and they used to flock and come to Jesus. But this was a different case. He never knew about Jesus. He just came and he looked at Jesus and he said, "If you can, you can heal me." In the same way, if we put our faith in Jesus, I think there is nothing impossible that Jesus can do for us.
I would say amen for that. Never have I ever read the scripture in that way. If thou wilt, thou can make me whole or clean. I know you can, but if only you will to do, you can really make me whole.
The point here is the way he trusted Jesus blindly.
And then what does Jesus say? "I am willing, be clean."
Be thou clean.
This is an interesting word. Even Ellen White talks about it and many commentators talk about it. Jesus said, "Let there be light. Let there be firmament. Let there be trees. Let there be stars." You know, there is power in the words of Jesus. Now when Jesus says, "Be thou clean," he is speaking with that power where new creation, new life would come out. And this man is really now made whole. And that is what Jesus does for you and me. Whether it is on Sabbath or not on Sabbath or in the normal days, you can come to Jesus and he's still willing to make you clean. He's still willing to deliver you from all kinds of maladies and sicknesses that you experience in your life. Because Jesus cares not only about our spiritual condition, but he cares about our physical condition. And not only about our physical condition, but he also cares about our mental conditions. Just as he cared for his disciples, he knows that they're going to leave home, so he takes them to their own home and spends the Sabbath there. He knows that the man over there is demon-possessed, so he heals the demon-possessed man and sets him free spiritually. And then we encounter this man who is physically made whole. And now even his connection is with God is set aright. And even now he can go back to his family. Mm-hmm. He can get back into the camp. We don't know how many years he spent outside in loneliness. But this is the thing that Jesus does for us. And all this, and after doing all these things, these extraordinary things, Jesus still says, can you keep it a secret? This is a mystery that we will keep on reading lesson after lesson. But as of now, what we can understand about why Jesus said keep it a secret is because he didn't want anything to hinder his ministry. If he can make this thing known to everyone, what would happen is that Jesus would set himself right against the priestly office of the Jewish community. And this would really hinder his ministry. Because Jesus came to the lost sheep of Israel. He came to save the Israelites. His preference first was Israelites because they were the chosen ones. And if anything would hinder the ministry, Jesus would really be affected by it. And that is a great truth that we need to learn. Just because something is good, it doesn't mean that it is always right. It can hinder the ministry. Sometimes we have to be quiet. And Jesus says to the man who is healed, now that you are healed, don't go on to people and say this, that you are healed and healed. Jesus made me whole. Be quiet. But unfortunately, the man cannot keep quiet. That's what happens when we receive salvation. We cannot keep quiet. We'll go on talking about Jesus. It did hinder the ministry of Jesus. But what is sure is that because of this leprosy healed man, the whole Decapolis, the 10 cities surrounding the land of Judea, they all got to know who Jesus was. As we promised in this lesson beginning, in this lesson we'll be learning about who Jesus is. A day with Jesus. We got to know who Jesus is. We'll still get to know as the following lessons go by until Mark chapter 8. The question of Mark is, who is Jesus? And then after Mark chapter 8, the tone of the whole Gospel of Mark will change. And we pray that you'll come back again next week to learn who Jesus is in the third lesson. Until then, be blessed.